Hi, everyone. Hey, if you want to take your seats, we're going to get started in about 2 minutes. So please take your seats. And we're starting a little bit later because I was standing out there waiting for Emmett McGroarty to get here, and he just got here. So thank you. I didn't want to stand up here and do a tap dance for an hour and a half. But anyway, we'll get started. Everybody's pretty much in their seats anyway. I want to thank everybody for coming. And I want to introduce George Chaplin. George is going to come up and lead us in prayer. He's going to lead us at the Pledge of Allegiance, and he's going to lead us in the National Anthem. So I'm going to cede the floor to George.
Okay, buddy. Well, good evening. Let's all stand, please, and we'll have a word of prayer, and then we're going to have you sing tonight. So, all right. Okay, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come here this evening, Lord, because we're concerned. We're concerned about our country. We're concerned about our state, our county. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you give guidance, give wisdom to our leaders, change the hearts of some of the leaders, Lord. We pray that you just give us a great understanding of what you want in our lives. We hope, Lord, that we will be a great testimony for you. We love you, and we ask, Lord, that you'd bless this meeting. In Christ's name, amen. Let's have the Pledge of Allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And I'm sure everybody can sing our national anthem, right? Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming through God's bright and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watch were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, George. I feel like you're on play ball right now. It is that time of year. Alan, can you cut the projector, please? Thank you for coming. It's a packed house. We're glad that you're here. I want to ask how many are here for the first time at a York 912 meeting? And how many? Good. There's a lot of people here. And how many people are here that are out of York County, that are not from York County? So we have a lot of people from out of the area. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Our goal with this meeting was to get the word out as much as possible and get as many people here as possible. We were hoping that PCN would cover it, and up until Tuesday it looked like they were, but something came up and they couldn't do it. How we operate as a group, York 912 Patriots, is that we're a volunteer-only group. I get no salary for being up here and speaking to you or putting the meeting together, my wife or the other leadership or anybody else that works in it. We get no salary for this. And this meeting was fairly expensive to put together with the sound and the video. So we're going to be passing around a donation jar. If you have money, please put some in. If you don't, you know, that's quite all right. But that's how we get by, and that's how we raise awareness. And how we raise awareness a lot is by radio ads and newspaper ads, and they're quite expensive. So we got to get the word out. So any donations are appreciated. We have merchandise out on the table. My two daughters are out there, and they'd be glad to help you at any moment. They're a little shy, so you have to talk to them. They won't talk to you. You have to talk to them. Did everyone pick up an agenda, a Common Core pamphlet? I know, we ran out, sorry. We have some, we got some more printed, copied, and up on the on the table in the back. If I can get somebody to come up from leadership or whoever to pass them out. If you don't have an agenda, Ed's coming back in, and just raise your hand. Also, the core, the Common Core Standards pamphlet was passed out with the agenda. If you don't have that, we can pass those out to you. And then if you're from York County, we have a York County rep contact sheet. So if you need any of this stuff, raise your hand and we'll get it to you. If you're not from York County, you can always go on our website. And my wife put together links for the Education Committee, the Appropriations Committee. You can go on our website, York912Patriots.com, and get all that information so you can contact your representatives. Because after you get done with this meeting, after you get done seeing what's happening, you're going to want to contact your representatives. Don't call them when you get home tonight because they're not in, but in the morning, call them when you get home. I want to also thank the other groups that helped us co-sponsor this meeting. The Adams 912 Patriots, actually Jeff Trish in the back there is the leader of the Adams County. He's passing out sheets. Cumberland County 912 Project and the Franklin County 912 Patriots. They're on the agenda. If you want to get a hold of them at all, their website is on the agenda. Also on the front, you will see that we've created an education committee. And if you're interested in helping to fight Common Core Standards, please see my beautiful wife, who's in the back there, Leanne. She can raise her hand. She started the committee, and they're meeting every Monday at 4 o'clock down at Denny's here on Route 30. Believe me, after what you are about to see, that the guest speaker is going to present to you this evening, you're going to want to fight this Common Core Standard. As it seems all the time, we are the last line of defense. We're it. Obamacare, many other things. 3 weeks ago, Leanne and I were minding our own business, you know, fighting against gun control, Obamacare, property taxes, out-of-control bloated government, our basic rights taken away, you know, just that ordinary stuff that us normal red-blooded patriots are doing over the last several years. But then 3 weeks ago, we saw Glenn Beck, and man, I love Glenn Beck. I mean, Glenn Beck's a great guy, and he does a lot of research, and he's got a lot of people. I'm going to drop that pen right there. He does a lot of research, and he's got a lot of research teams, but and they dig up all this stuff. And when I saw this show 3 weeks ago, I'm saying, really, Glenn? There can't be anything else that we need to fight. I mean, really? But no. He brought Common Core out into the light. How many people have heard of Common Core Standards before 3 weeks ago? Good. That's more than I expected, because I had no idea. And I'm not a low information voter. So a lot of people that are involved didn't know anything about it. But you know, it's just taking our children from us at the age of four and directing their whole lives and setting their path while data mining them to take control of our entire lives. That's all Common Core is. It was only part of the stimulus bill of 2009 where the entire structure was set up for implementation. It's only been begun in 46 states, including Pennsylvania. I hope that everyone received a York County rep contact sheet. You'll have to educate your reps, because I called Seth Grove, who's my state rep, 2 weeks ago, and I left a message on his phone asking him to, you know, what he's doing about Common Core Standards. And he called me back and left a message, and he said, well, Scott, those were set up in 1999, and I don't know what's wrong. I don't know what the problem is. Well, then I called him back, and he kind of backpedaled on it. He said, well, yeah, they were set up in 2010, and they're just being the state is just changing them so to PA standards, so it's no big deal. Don't worry about it. It is a big deal because our reps don't know what's going on. They have no idea. Someone sent me a letter from that Ron Miller sent one of his constituents, and he said, "Oh, this is okay. It's already been implemented. You can't stop it." So you're just going to have to ride the wave. And it's just like Obamacare. Hey, it's all set up. Just got to ride the wave. Just let it go. But there are ways to fight these things, and it's at the state level. These guys represent us, but they don't know they don't know what's going on. Well, our guest tonight knows exactly what is going on, and he was on that Glenn Beck show that I saw 3 weeks ago. His name is Emmett McGroarty, and he's executive director of the Preserve Innocence Initiative at the American Principles Project. And he drove up here from Washington, D.C. He got here about 5 after 7. I guess he didn't realize the traffic coming up 83 up to York is bad. But we did have a pinch hitter in line if Emmett didn't show up, and that's Judge Mike Flannelly, who's running for the Court of Common Pleas, who is a current sitting judge. He kind of resembles Emmett in somewhat of a way, but he had agreed to come up here and talk about whatever he wanted to talk about. We didn't have to worry about that. Mike's a stand-up guy. He stepped up, but we didn't have to need him. Emmett, are you here? There he is. Emmett's in the corner. Come on up. Please give Emmett a hand.
Thank you all. I think fundamentally what I'm here to talk about is it's our founding. The British historian who thinks very highly of Americans, Paul Johnson, once said that other countries have tried to copy our Constitution and copied it pretty much word for word, clause for clause, but they've still failed as a country. And I think the reason why these other countries have failed is they didn't really have the Declaration underlying the Constitution and the idea that our rights come from the Creator and that we're all created equal. And when you have that underlying the Constitution, you really hold our founding close to your heart. And it really impresses upon you the idea that government has to be citizen-directed as the founders intended. And I would say as God intended. Otherwise, he would have made us all equal. These other countries have failed. And so why is this a constitutional issue? I think this is a fundamental constitutional issue, and it's more profound than the 10th Amendment or federalism. This goes to the very heart of the Constitution. And the idea when I go through this story of how we got the Common Core, you'll see what happened was that the constitutional construct was completely evaded. And what that means is the people, the will of the people, was completely evaded, and it was circumvented. And that puts us in the category of these other countries that copied our Constitution but failed. It wasn't held close to their heart. Now, in a sense, it really wasn't the people's fault. Scott was talking about your legislators don't know. That's by intent. So myself and my colleagues are fellow travelers at Heritage Foundation and Pioneer Institute up in Boston, and Bill Everts out at Hoover Institute have been traveling across the country talking to groups for the last 2.5-3 years. And talking to legislators about the Common Core, And here's the thing. For the first 2 years that we were doing this, 2.5 years that we were doing this, we never, ever came across a legislator who knew what the Common Core was and how it got inflicted on the states. They had no notice, of what it was. They had no true notice of really what was happening. And as a result, they never had an opportunity to take the issue to the people. And this is really, it's a Common Core system, as we'll get into. It's, when conservatives think of education, you think of reading, writing, and arithmetic, right? When statists think of education, they think of everything that can be controlled through education, which includes a managed economy. It includes values, right? The idea, you got to keep your values in your home or within the four walls of the church. You can't bring it out into public. You can't bring it to the workplace. That might affect workplace productivity. Liberty might be bad for productivity. And so we'll go through this, but what strikes me, it really is an emotional issue when you think what's happened. But you go through the issue and you see all of the checks and balances that the founders put in place. They've all failed. They've all been evaded. Bicameral government, bicameral legislature, division of the branches of the executive government, federalism. It's all failed. Everything meant to protect the Constitution, to protect our rights and liberties, it all failed. So the Common Core is a model for, the complete end run around the Constitution. So it's all failed except one thing. And this is the thing that's starting to get them nervous. The one thing that hasn't failed is the will of the people. And people are starting to realize what happened, and they're starting to rise up and get back to something that our founders intended, get back to something that sparked our country and launched our country. The idea of citizen-directed government, the idea that government and legislators and governors and presidents work for the people and are to take their direction from the people. And we've lost that in the idea of big international treaties and international corporations. The idea, probably since World War II, that everything is big and powerful and one person can't change anything. But I think this is the hope. The Common Core is showing us that we can reclaim the Constitution. And we have evidence. So in Indiana, a very powerful movement is underway. It was launched about a year ago. Now it includes over 30 tea parties. It includes teacher groups now. It includes 20 other groups in Indiana. And it was started a year ago by two moms. And they say, and I think it's pretty accurate, they spent $1,000 in 1,000 hours, and they're going to bring down, I think, what is a $2 billion effort. And that's going on now across the country. It's going on in Utah and Missouri and Alabama and Georgia. Georgia, 2-3 months ago, was thinking, activists there were thinking, well, we'll never get out because we got race to the top money. We got $400 million. Now they just need to turn one person, the governor, a Republican. They need to turn him, and they're out. And I'll tell you, if he doesn't turn, he's out. that's how intense people are about this. It's the Constitution. It's their children. It's one of their fundamental rights. It's one of our fundamental rights, the right to shepherd our children's upbringing. So what happened here is this is a whole system, so bear with me now. Standards are basically instructions to teachers, all right? And the progressives for a long time have had the idea that we need nationwide standards because we need to control, that's the progressive thinking. They thought that, we need to control what children learn, and we need to do that centrally because we can't trust local communities to do that because, well, who's in charge of local communities but, people and parents. So they can't be trusted. So you need this managed from Washington because Washington does everything else so well. This idea has been around for a while. We need national standards. And you probably remember 20 years ago, actually 18 years ago, there was an attempt to have national history standards, and people got wind of it. It was Lynn Cheney at American Enterprise Institute that who raised the red flag as to the content of those standards. And then the Senate, in a resolution, voted it down 99-1. The one dissent thought that the resolution wasn't strong enough. But the progressives learned a valuable lesson then, a very valuable lesson. You can't take an issue like that to the people. You can't let them have a say in it because they'll never approve it. And so that's what they learned. So the standards were kept alive by a band of progressives, including the Hunt Institute in North Carolina. The Hunt Institute in North Carolina, around 2005, 2006, recruited the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation into the effort. And the Gates Foundation was coming off its latest educational policy failure, small schools, so it was looking for somewhere else to throw its money to do good for us. And it signed on to this effort. And then it recruited two private trade associations into the effort. And this is important. Those two trade associations were the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. And at the heart of it, when you hear the Common Core people, they have a litany of slogans to describe the Common Core. They're state-led, they're fewer, clearer, deeper, rigorous, internationally benchmarked. All of those things are false. Objectively speaking, they're all false. So the first one, state-led. They say it's state-led because of the involvement of the National Governors Association and Council of Chief State School Officers. Well, let's look at those two entities. They're private corporations. The National Governors Association, for instance, won't tell us what states pay dues to the Governors Association. We know that not all of them do. And they're not subject to open records or open meetings or any of the hallmarks of democracy or government, not subject to freedom of information requests. That's one little tidbit about them. Secondly, so they're taking money from the states, and I guess in a sense purporting to represent the states or the governors. They say they're state-led. The standards were state-led, so I guess they're really purporting to represent the states. Then they're taking money, and actually far more money, from private entities like the Gates Foundation. Far, far more money. I think the figure is they've paid to National Government Association and Council of Chief State School Officers something like $70 million. Okay. So what do they do with that money? With respect to the Common Core, that money up through 2008 was for strategy. It was for advocacy and making a plan to implement the Common Core. And then starting in 2009, there was some money paid to actually develop the Common Core. So put those together. They're taking money from the states and basically saying, well, we're representing the states. Then they're taking money from third parties, and third parties are telling them, well, you know, we want national standards. And they're turning around and essentially lobbying their own members. They're going into the states and whipping up a frenzy among the selected stakeholders, telling them that you gotta implement these Common Core standards. You gotta accept these Common Core standards. So, anyway, up through 2008, they're putting their plan together, and pretty much they're expecting an Obama victory. President Obama gets elected, and then in December 2008, the Gates and Council of Chief State School Officers issue a report called Benchmarking for Success. And you know, the report notes that it's funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And it's basically, you read it, it's basically a plan for race to the top. And it calls for incentivizing getting money to incentivize the states to accept and adopt the Common Core. So so this got embedded in the stimulus bill. So remember, you know, President Obama gets sworn in late January 2009. A couple weeks later, the stimulus bill, big stimulus bill is passed. They're working on this long before that. So the Department of Education gets $4.35 billion in largely discretionary money. And they turn around, and a couple days later, Arne Duncan is asked, well, what are you going to do with this money? And he says on C-SPAN, he says, I really like the work that Gates and the Governors Association is doing on national standards, and I want to be the catalyst to make that happen. And so they announced this plan, and the plan is for the states to enter a competition to win money, it's called Race to the Top, and it's really a race. It's a race to a monopoly, or it's a race to abdicate state autonomy over education. So, just a couple of little bits about the plan. You couldn't win Race to the Top money unless you were committed to the Common Core. It was mathematically impossible. Not only that, but the evaluation of a state's application was an evaluation to the state's commitment to the president's education reform ideas. Those ideas in Benchmarking for Success. So to show your robust commitment to that, you had to, as a state, demonstrate to the administration that you were going to commit to these reforms regardless of whether you won the money. So let me just give you a quick story. So I won't say her name. Someone here told me that they just got a letter from the department, Pennsylvania Department of Education, on the Common Core, and they asked me, "Well, why do you think they sent me that letter?" And I said, "I think they're getting nervous because people are realizing what happened." So you had to commit to the standards, regardless of whether or not you won the money. Then, that's not all. Another little twist about it is, well, the standards hadn't actually been written. And the assessments, so then there's assessments tied to the standards that you had to commit to. The assessments are developed with federal grant money, basically under the thumb of the federal government. And they act as the enforcement of the standards. So you pass the standards, and then the states had to sign up for one of these testing consortia, federally funded testing consortia, and that's the strong arm, because the tests are aligned to the standards. And then the teachers, the federal government wants the teachers evaluated according to how the students do on the standards, as well as the schools and basically the state. So it's high stakes testing, and the standards are the enforcement piece. Well, the standards weren't written at the time. The states had to commit to the race to the top. The assessments still haven't been developed yet. I'll give you the timeline. So race to the top, there were two initial rounds of grants, Race to the Top 1 and Race to the Top 2. At the end of those two rounds, you had over 40 states committed to the Common Core and the non-existent assessments. So the first round of Race to the Top applications, the states committed to the Common Core and the assessments, first round was due in January 19th, 2010. The first draft of the standards came out in March 2010. Then the second round of Race to the Top applications was due June 1, 2010. The final draft of the standards came out June 2nd, 2010. And so in that, the states had to commit to the standards. And then the administration gave states two more months to formally commit to the standards, because I guess they thought it would be difficult for state boards of education to sign on to standards that hadn't been produced yet. So this is in June 2010, and they had to commit by August 2010. Most state boards of education met once, maybe twice, between when the final draft came out and the August 2nd deadline. So, the standards are being marketed as that they would transform the education of every child in America. Yeah, well, it's true. but even if they were just tweaks of existing standards, you would still expect that the state should have the opportunity to fully evaluate the standards, maybe have them piloted, look at the evidence upon which they were based, which is actually non-existent, compare them to their old standards, and give notice to the legislature, and I don't know what else should be done. Maybe give notice to the people. There wasn't time to do that in any real meaning of the term. That's why your legislators don't know what's going on, and that's why very few people know what's going on. So what did we sign up for? Well, the system, the way it was implemented, basically cut out the ultimate earthly judge, the American people, from the process. So it's no wonder that what we got was a bucket of junk. And from the poison tree comes poison fruit. The Common Core was never field tested. The content experts, the real content experts on the Common Core Validation Committee, refused to sign off on them. Sandra Stotsky is on the Validation Committee, perhaps the country's preeminent standards expert. And by the way, even the Common Core proponents admit that. In a Pioneer Commission white paper, she concluded that the Common Core's college readiness standards do not point to a level of intellectual achievement that signifies readiness for authentic college-level work. So I'll go through go through some of the qualitative issues of the standards. But by the way, I think even if everyone in this room agreed that the standards were perfect, it's still, this Common Core system is still a bad idea, because the Common Core, in adopting the Common Core, the state and the people have given up a tremendous amount of autonomy, right? So in adopting the Common Core, each state that did so obligated itself to adopt the Common Core word for word. You can't change any of it. You can add 15%, but you can't change any of it. And that 15%, if you so add it, isn't going to be tested on the test, on the high stakes test. So there's a much lower incentive to teach that 15%. So going forward, the Common Core is owned by the National Governors Association and Council of Chief State School Officers. They put a copyright on it and issued a limitation of liability. Reads like the back of a cigarette carton, you know, excusing themselves from any harm that results as a result of use of the standards. But going forward, there's going to be tremendous governance issues, right? So if all the states have to take a common test, well, you don't want to administer that test, with one state administering it, say with 4 or 5 year weeks of additional schooling under the belt in other states. So you're going to have to align the calendars somehow of all the states. And then there's the issue of governance of the standards. Well, who decides whether, an amendment to the standards has to be made, and how is that decision made? Well, I mean, if we go by the precedent of the Common Core, I guess that's not a problem, right? You all have no say in it. But there is no structure for that. And it's some of the states, it's interesting, some of the superintendents who signed on to this are now trying to justify it, and they're saying, well, my state is part of the governing committee of the consortia, so we'll have a lot of influence in the governance of the standards. You think that's a defense? I mean, before you signed on the Common Core, your state had 100% control over its standards. Now you have to get permission from a major, at best a majority of 45 states, plus probably the federal government and the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. So let's look at the standards. Sandra Stotsky says that the average reading level of the passages on the Common Core tests now being developed, it probably means that the reading level is at about the seventh grade level. She says that the ELA standards fall far below what other English-speaking nations or regions require of college-intending high school graduates. When Sandra was on the validation committee, she asked the writers of the Common Core to point her to the evidence upon which the standards were based, and they never responded to her request. She asked them to identify which countries they were benchmarked to, because that was one of the promises of the Common Core, and they never identified those countries. What does the Common Core do with ELA? Basically, it dramatically reduces the study of classic literature in favor of informational texts. So informational texts are things like government bulletins, passages from computer manuals, treaties, executive orders, things of that ilk. And this presents a number of problems. As Stotsky points out, it's through the study of classic literature that children develop analytical abilities and learn to express themselves. It's through the study of classic literature that children learn prudential decision-making vicariously, and vicariously study empathy. In short, I think it's through the study of classic literature that America had a very rich tradition of, children learn how to fully exercise their liberties, or it aids in the full exercise of their liberties. It helps prepare children to be able to enter the public square should the spirit call them. But that's probably not a concern of the propagators of the Common Core, since they took such great pains to exclude all of you from the process in the first place. So what we have is it's a decidedly European philosophy of education. You're educating children, students, to be cogs in the economic wheel of a managed economy. You're not exercising them to be Americans. And you think about the spirit of American, it's the can-do spirit, both economically and politically, which I think everyone in this room partakes in. So I think it's a tremendous, tremendous problem for the future of our country. Let's look at the math standards. Dr. James Milgram, professor of Stanford University, was also on the Common Core Validation Committee, and he refused to sign off on the standards. He said they weren't comparable to the expectations in other leading nations. And he said it's almost a joke to think that that students who master the Common Core standards would be ready for math at a university. So what does the Common Core do with math? Well, one of the slogans of the Common Core is that it's fewer standards, and you go into them deeper. And math, it's true that they have fewer standards. They've taken out some content. For instance, it fails to teach prime factorization and consequently does not include teaching about least common denominators or greatest common factors. It fails to include conversions among fractions, decimals, and percents. It fails to require proficiency with addition and subtraction until grade 4, a grade behind the expectations of the high-performing states and our international competitors. It fails to require proficiency with multiplication using the standard algorithm, the step-by-step standard or best way for solving a problem. It fails to do this for multiplication until grade 5, a grade behind the expectations of high-performing states or international competitors. It fails to require proficiency with division using the standard algorithm until grade 6, again, a grade behind expectations of high-performing countries. It does not start teaching decimals until grade 4, about 2 years behind the more rigorous state standards. And it fails to teach about key geometrical concepts, such as the area of a triangle, the sum of all of angles in a triangle, etc. As a matter of fact, when it comes to geometry, it basically throws out Euclidean geometry, the way of studying geometry for thousands of years. It throws it out for an experimental system that has failed in every instance in which it has been implemented in K-12. Most notably in the former Soviet Union, about 30 years ago, it failed at a gifted and talented school. And that's now our national system of teaching geometry. And this is what happens when you cut the judge out of the process. So in short, what they do with math is they teach they go to fuzzy math. So we'll go to students and tell them, well, there's lots of different ways of solving problems. Let's investigate that, and we'll come up with the different ways of solving them, which, of course, frustrates the children. Frustrates me just talking about it. And it delays the teaching of the standard algorithms. So you have this delayed process. And so that gets pushed back, so that's why they have to cut out some content. And then the ultimate result is Algebra 1 has to be taught in grade 9 instead of grade 8. Now, here's a fascinating story. Over the last 15 years or so, the trend has been to move Algebra 1 down to 8th grade. And then that allows for a comfortable progression of learning so that students can get to calculus in 12th grade. Common Core pushes Algebra 1 back to 9th grade. And then when this issue was raised, they said, well, we have an accelerated program where you can still get to calculus by 12th grade. And that's true, but here's the problem with it. California, for instance, was heavy into this trend of moving Algebra 1 to 8th grade, and what happened was they saw a tremendous growth in the number and percentage of economically disadvantaged students who reached calculus by 12th grade. And the reason was because when you have the compressed schedule, who can best navigate that? Well, the students who can best navigate that are the ones in general, are the ones who come from families who can afford tutoring and summer courses. So that's what we're dealing with now in math. So then we get to the data collection. So as part of the stimulus bill, all the states, there were separate pots of money in the stimulus bill. One pot of money, the states had to promise to build massive student databases. And almost all the states took that money and they're building these massive student databases. And right now there's the requirements for the data that needs to be collected are pretty basic demographic type and testing information. Then the Department of Education has a national education data model that has about 400 data points that the department wants collected. And that includes very personal information, very personal family information, in requests of kind of extracurricular activities of students, kind of healthcare, health issues of students, learning issues. At one point, they had up there assessments of mental and social well-being. They started getting criticism for that, and they took that down. I think it's still lurking back there, ready to pop up. Also, things like voter registration, religious identity. Why does government need all this money? Well, in the progressive world, data is king. You can't manage people, you can't manage education or the economy unless you have lots of information. But that's not all. So there was a privacy protection law, still is a privacy protection law. It was passed in 1974 called the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act. So after putting this data collection bid in the stimulus bill and race to the top, then a year later, the Obama administration changed the privacy law. Well, actually, it didn't change the privacy law. It changed the regulations that implement the privacy law. And it changed it in such a way that the privacy law went from being privacy protection to a data sharing mechanism for government. So it allows for much greater collection and sharing of data. So now government can share student level data from, it can share it within every department within a state government. It can share it with other state governments, can share it with the federal government. The federal government can share it with other federal departments. And it can even share it with private entities. And no one has found yet a prohibition that requires those private entities to be within the jurisdiction of the United States. So this is, I mean, it's part of the Common Core program. Let's do one other thing about the data collection. The Department of Labor, the Federal Department of Labor, also has a data collection effort. And in its grants, it requires the potential grantees, the states, to explain how its data, its Department of Labor data collection efforts are going to align and work with the Department of Education's data collection efforts. So I think this is where we are now. We need to get out of the Common Core. The only way we're going to get out of it is in every state we need at least two moms like we have in Indiana, or at least three moms like we have in Utah. And I think if we have that, we'll have a groundswell of people that will take us out of this system, that will demand that their state governments pass new updated privacy legislation that gives parents the right to know what is in their students' records, gives them the right to correct the information that's wrong that's in their students' records, that gives them the right to know where that those records can be shared and where they have been shared, and gives them the right to opt out of such sharing. To a bureaucrat, maybe to a legislator or governor, that sounds onerous. To a citizen, though, I think it is daunting for the government to have the authority to have that information. It's not their information. They have no authority to have it unless the people generally give them that authority, unless the individual specifically gives them the authority for his data. I think this is a basic liberty right. And it needs to be changed. We need to get out of the Common Core. So the good thing is that it can be done, all this can be done within the states. And I think this is what's going to lead us back to a much more robust appreciation and fidelity to our founding and our Constitution. I think this battle will do it. Why? It's because to win it, we don't need the Supreme Court. We don't need the presidency. We don't need the U.S. Senate. And we don't need the U.S. House of Representatives. And we certainly don't need the U.S. Department of Education. To win it, all we need to do is for citizens to convince their senator and convince their legislator that they had better do everything they can to get us out, or they're going to be tossed out. We have a friendly journalist who reports on this. I mean, she's a constitutionalist, and she does fabulous investigative work on this. And she knows she has some contacts in some groups that are getting money from the Common Core effort. And one of her contacts called her up last week and said that legislators, particularly Republican legislators, are running scared about this issue. They don't want anything to do with the Common Core. They're scared. I think that's the first step. The next step is for them to get a backbone and do something. We're very hopeful about what can be done. a senator in Indiana told us that it's amazing now. People have lost the way so much now that the two moms tell me down at the State House, there aren't any citizens down there. The legislators and the senator tells us that he rarely gets calls from constituents. So, you know, he hear from two or three constituents and the legislators start getting nervous. So this can be done. There's groups all over Pennsylvania now that have asked for briefings on the Common Core. And I think it's a wonderful effort to get in. I think it's going to rejuvenate the idea of citizen-directed government, and we'll win on this, we'll win on the privacy, and then we'll just keep going. We'll keep going on issue after issue after issue. It's exhilarating when you realize that citizen-directed government really can work and that a couple of people can start a movement and change something. And I think it in a couple of years, it's going to be a much brighter outlook for the Constitution and for our rights. It's a daunting effort, though. You know, it's a daunting effort. Joy Pullman of Heartland Institute estimated that the Gates Foundation alone has spent $163 million on propagating the Common Core. In Utah last year, the moms out there they've grown their network to like 4,000 people now, they were making tremendous progress, and now I think the governor was coming their way. What happened over the summer, the National Governors Association appointed him as chair of its education committee. But I think with what Glenn Beck is doing and Michelle Malkin and others, he's going to regret that decision very, very soon. I think when people realize what the National Governors Association is and what an affront it is to governance, the idea that legislators and governors should be responding to a private association on issues. You can't have accountability two ways. You know, it goes to special interests in the federal government, or it goes to the people. And I think that there's going to be an awakening on what's happening. But it is daunting, though. So we told a story about 18 years ago. Lynn Cheney at American Enterprise Institute raising the red flag about national history standards. So what happened this time, March 2009, right when the Common Core is announced, Bill Gates Foundation gave American Enterprise Institute $1 million grant for education. And now, since then, I think they've gotten a total of $3 million. And I mean, what do they have to do for that? Well, all you have to do is just not, you know, I mean, you're the entity that took down the last edition of national standards. So if you're just neutralized, then that's basically a victory for the progressives. It's a defeat for the Constitution. But so AEI has been astonishingly neutral on the standards, actually kind of cheerleading the administration. Oh, I hope you guys implement this correctly, or it could all fail. My group I work with, American Principles Project, we joined the ALEC, American Legislative Exchange Council, we joined their education committee or task force for purposes of introducing a model legislation to get out of the Common Core. That was July 2011. And why did we do that? Because at the time, you had to beg a newspaper or any entity to write something about the Common Core. And this is a way of getting a public debate. So we joined in July. There was a meeting a couple weeks later. The resolution was tabled because legislators hadn't heard anything about it. But still, Jeb Bush sent his people out to lobby the meeting against us. And then we had a big fight in December, and we won. The legislators voted to get out of the Common Core. We won despite the fact a couple weeks before that meeting in November, ALEC took a $380,000 grant from the Gates Foundation for Education. It's very, you know, Wall Street Journal, News Corp, which owns the Wall Street Journal, was there at ALEC lobbying heavily against our measure. Why? Well, they have some education subsidiaries that are invested in the Common Core, basically in providing Common Core technologies. Financial Times. Financial Times is owned by Pearson, which is the largest textbook company in the country. It's a British company. Robert Scott, the commissioner of education, former commissioner of education for Rick Perry, when Rick Perry rejected the Common Core, Robert Scott said, we fought two wars against the British Empire, and now we're turning it all over to a British national corporation. So it's daunting, but I think in this fight, I'm going to side with the Constitution and liberty, the Declaration, and moms who are willing to spend $1,000 and 1,000 hours anytime over a $2 billion effort. Amen. So, thank you. I would love to take questions. I do want to say, by all means, please call your legislators and tell them they need to get out. It's not negotiable. Need to get us out. We understand you didn't know what was happening. Now you need to get us out. And your governor. I have about 50 DVDs here of the video that Jane Robbins, my colleague at APP and Concerned Women of America, produced on the Common Core. Those are free for the take, and I could send more up to you. I just ask if you take one of those videos, please use it to bring more people into the movement. I urge you all, maybe I get the sense that you all are already doing this. I urge you all to be like the founders, and to basically have committees of correspondence and to be continually reaching out to other groups and pulling them into this effort. And I think within a couple of months, Pennsylvania will have a robust movement that it will have the legislators and the governors standing with you or fully on the run. So. But, pardon me?
Questions?
Yes.
Okay. Question right here. Mr. McGroarty, I just was, you mentioned the lady who was doing a lot of good research writing about Common Cores. And I was wondering if you could give us her name and how we could begin to avail ourselves of some of her writing.
Yeah, I'll give you a couple of sites. There's a network. It's called truthinamericaneducation.com. And it's a network of people. It's not owned by any group. It was started by four individuals, and it's just an information sharing network. So that's at truthinamericaneducation.com. If you have a group, like a patriotic group or a civic group, you want to list on that group, please do so. That's tremendously helpful. It was really helpful in the early goings, but when someone sees a group up there that they identify with, that makes them more willing, I think, to look into the issue. So please email me your groups you want put up on that website, but see that truthinamericaneducation.com. There's a resource page there that has white papers and materials on the Common Core. Jane Robbins and I wrote a white paper called Controlling Education from the Top. It's a primer on the Common Core. And I think it's a good explanation of what went on. It has over 120 footnotes in it. That's available on truthinamericaneducation.com. It's also available on AmericanPrinciplesProject.org, and it's available. It was published by Pioneer Institute in Massachusetts. Pioneer Institute in Massachusetts has done. They did the original work on evaluating the Common Core and studying it for its legality and its cost implications. We didn't get into the cost implications. They're tremendous. But Pioneer Institute, well, why Pioneer Institute in Boston? Because Pioneer Institute, under the direction of Sandra Stotsky, developed the best standards in the country. And they had a whole system of education reform that was populist-based. And their achievement skyrocketed to the point where everyone, it was agreed that they had the best education system in the country. They scored at the top of all the achievement tests in the country, and in math and science, they're right up there with the likes of Singapore. And so with some of the other people, Joy Pullman of Heartland Institute has been just doing fabulous research and investigative work on this. Michelle Malkin, of course, Lindsay Burke at Heritage, Bill Evers at Hoover Institute. So, yes.
I mean, I have a question. Leanne had said that we had this overhead projector. Would you be willing to do a math equation?
Yeah, I apologize. I forgot my slides for that.
Oh, that's okay. That's fine. That's okay. I have another question now.
Those are actually, you can see those on truthinamericaneducation.com. If you go down, it was a post a week or two ago, lays out math examples in between the standard algorithm and the Common Core. So you have, you know, a subtraction problem, you know, 54 minus 12. And then you have the standard way of solving it in one step. And then you have the Common Core way of solving it, which goes down for like four or five pages. So the Common Core, I mean, the more you read into it, it eliminates cursive, by the way. That's fewer standards.
Hey, Emmett, I'm going to, Leanne would like to mention some things that are Pennsylvania specific to to Common Core. Do you mind if she does that quick?
Not at all.
Okay.
I just want to make this announcement before people get up and leave when you're done speaking. But specific to Pennsylvania, there is a new website called knowpacommoncore.com. And they also have a Facebook page, and it's Pennsylvanians Against Common Core. So if you want to link with others, this is where we would suggest that you go. And Emmett had mentioned cost. The conservative estimate to implement this fully in Pennsylvania is $650 million. So our school districts are already cash-strapped, and so are the property tax owners. And we will be saddled with this bill. And this is the conservative estimate. And I don't know if you knew this, but the State Board of Education is not elected. It is 21 members who are appointed by the governor who decided for our state what would happen.
That means you have you have two avenues you can get out. You can get out legislatively or by convincing the governor that he needs to pull Pennsylvania out. And I believe he wasn't even the governor when this came down, so.
I have another question. You say call your legislators, which probably many of us will do. If we say to them, we don't want Common Core, they say, I don't know what you're talking about. What then is our response? Is there something we can direct them to, specifically for Common Core, specifically for this privacy legislation that you're talking about? Are there other states that have good legislation on the books that Pennsylvania can copy? How do we proceed?
No one has good legislation on the books. We're working with a number of states to get legislation enacted. So there's efforts underway in on the Common Core in, I guess, about 7 or 8 states. A good number of those have privacy legislation components, like Georgia and Alabama. So I would suggest sending them the legislation in Georgia and telling them about it. And you could send them this white paper. It is too much for them to read. I was trying to think. Joy Pullman has had a couple of recent pieces on the Common Core. So send her a piece or two of that. There's another piece. I'll send it to Leanne. There's a piece I love. So in Indiana, red state, right? And the elected superintendent of education, Tony Bennett, was a Mitch Daniels protege. Mitch Daniels sat on the board of directors of the Hunt Institute, that from whence all this came. And so he was up for re-election and cruising for an easy victory. He's a Republican, had the full support of the governor. It's a red state. He had over $2 million in the bank. His opponent had a couple $100,000. She was a Democrat. So there's no way he was going to lose. And he fought us. He was the one who came down to Alec and was the primary debater on their side. Extreme confidence, some would say, and some would say extreme arrogance. Then, you know, he was calling each of the senators in during the election, asking them how their election was going. A funny thing happened. The Democrat candidate ran to his right. And she came out against the Common Core and she started making arguments in favor of local control of education. And she beat him. And so he's out. Now he's the superintendent. He's the hired superintendent in Florida. Well, a couple weeks ago, he had to go to his legislature because Florida is, Jeb Bush still has tremendous influence there. He's one of the propagators of the Common Core. He's taking a lot of Gates money. So 2 weeks ago, Tony Bennett had to go to his legislature and ask for an additional $441 million for the technology implementation component of the Common Core.
You might not know the answer to this. What about, how would this affect homeschoolers and private schoolers?
Homeschoolers are in trouble. They're the safest, but they're still in trouble. So what's happened is, the architect of the Common Core is a fellow named David Coleman. The SATs are run by the College Examination Board. I think over the last 10 years, the College Examination Board has taken about $30 million from Bill Gates. And last summer, the College Examination Board hired David Coleman as its president, and David Coleman said, I'm going to align the SAT with the Common Core. And then the ACT is already aligned with it. So you have a situation of the country's moving away from classic education and homeschool students are going to have to study for the test or take the test, and their results won't be reflective of the quality of their education. And sadly, some of the homeschool textbook companies are aligning themselves with the Common Core.
Do you have a handout that you can spoon feed our politicians with? It's only maybe a half a page?
Yeah. there is a, you all can borrow and change it around. The Tea Parties up in Indiana got together and did a trifold flyer. And I'll email that to you all. It's excellent. And then on the back, they have the national groups that are against the Common Core, and then they've listed all the Indiana ones. So you all could just swap out the Indiana ones for the Pennsylvania ones. But it's highly, highly effective. My email is, it's long. I have cards here, but it's emcgroarty@americanprinciplesproject.org. Yeah. Yeah, there is an acronym. See, I'm from Washington, right? There is an acronym, but the acronym's longer. So E-McGroarty is emcgroarty@americanprinciplesproject.org. I have cards over here in the corner. Yeah, okay, great.
Hey, Mr. McGroarty, thanks for coming. My name is Jason McNew. I'm a school board director in Upper Adams County. And I don't see enough of the public and the parents and stuff out at the meetings. We don't see them very often. I really think we'd like to see people out there. And it is important to contact your legislator. My local legislator, Will, I can't remember his last name at the moment, Tallman is here. Thanks, Will. Don't assume that your school board directors are automatically going to support this. I know the other people on my board, they have no love of, for instance, No Child Left Behind, because we now know that this supports special interests. And it's important to remember there are 501 school districts in Pennsylvania. So engage with your local lawmakers, but also go to your board meetings and engage with your local school board directors. Because if you could bring these 501 districts to bear against this, I think that's going to have a big impact.
That's a well said, very good point. Yeah, show up at that local school board meeting and make yourself heard. Yeah, another thing that's happening in South Carolina and some of the other states, people are telling the county-level GOP and state-level GOP that they're going to hold them accountable for who sits on the State Board of Education and who sits on the education committees in both houses. And that's highly effective. And so I think it, what brought that about in South Carolina is a realization that there are 18 members on the State Board of Education. 17 of those are appointed by the legislature, and they're all liberal. And that's South Carolina. So
This has been really great. Thank you, Scott, and the other groups for bringing Emmett here. My name's Katie Abram. I work for Americans for Prosperity, and we are not happy about the Common Core. As a mom, I have two kids in elementary school, and I have seen some of this math where I can't even figure it out myself. I mean, you're talking elementary level math. And I told my husband, I'm like, how is it that we can't sit here and understand? I need to get away from this. We can't even understand the math at an elementary school level. I spoke to Senator Mike Fulmer, who's the chair of the Education Committee in Harrisburg, and they're actually going to be holding hearings about this in May.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and he's a good guy.
That is great.
But here's my question. I've been back and forth on Twitter with the press secretary of Secretary of Education in our state and another activist. We've been bugging him on Twitter. And I asked him, what the ramifications would be if we don't follow the Common Core curriculum. And he said, well, it's not curriculum. We get to decide what the curriculum is here in Pennsylvania. What do you say to that? That, I mean, he really thinks we're going to have control over this, just like with everything else that the federal government feeds down our throats.
Yeah, it's see if I can find it. I have a quote from Bill Gates on that. Let's see if... I don't know if I'm going to be able to find it quick enough, but basically Bill Gates told the National Council of Legislators that the idea is that you have standards, you have assessments aligned to those standards, and then the curriculum has to align to the standards and the assessments. With those two bookends, you can control curriculum. So, and... you know, the deputy, the former deputy of the Texas Department of Education told me, he said, like, well, normally you write your standards, you have your curriculum, and then you write the tests from the curriculum. So he said, you know, there's basically a curriculum out there. And you look at the, there's a discussion of it in this white paper. But in the federal assessment grants, testing consortia are obligated to developing curriculum frameworks. So that really goes against the grain of what he's saying. You can choose a textbook, but the textbook has to teach the Common Core.
Touch on that data mining, and one of the other facets I don't think you got into was some type of it almost sounds like science fiction, where it's a facial interpretation software that judges attitudes, demeanor, intelligent level by reading people's facial expressions in the kids. And another side effect or facet of the data mining is the state Common Core deciding who's best suited for different occupations going forward.
Yeah, there's lots of different new ways coming online to collect data. And a lot more, the Common Core is pushing, so increased use of computers and computer programs. So they're, and of course the corporate world is just in a feeding frenzy on this, coming up with all different new ways of collecting data, measuring student intensity, measuring their commitment to their studies, all kinds of attitudinal behaviors. So this is all part of it. And it's all coming down. It's all unaddressed by the people. It's all being pushed on the bureaucracies through the technology companies. They have their own lobby group called the Data Quality Initiative. And all these corporate entities and these supposedly conservative organizations like Fordham Institute are partners of the Data Quality Initiative. So, I know that's one of the it's one of the new ways they want to. There's companies out there that say, look, we can collect information on students on how they react to what's on the screen, and then we can do studies to evaluate teaching and evaluate their progress. So that's all coming forward.
I just read. I just read Michelle Rhee's new book, Radical, and there's a lot to like about Michelle Rhee and what she's done, but you get on in the book and you find out that she's very much on board with Race to the Top, with the Gates Foundation, and One thing she never mentioned, Common Core, in the book. Is her new group Students First on board with Common Core or not?
Yeah, they're on board with it. I think they've lobbied in favor of it in some of the states, I believe. One of the things I think the Tea Parties and 912 groups would be especially good at this. One of the things that have to be on guard about is the alignment of corporate special interests with government. That is a powerful, well-funded corporate entity trying to lobby and manipulate government to favor it in the marketplace. And education, it's like a $600 billion a year industry. So there's a tremendous amount of pressure to do that. So some of these charter school groups, like Pearson, for instance, has been buying charter schools and charter school chains. So just because something is in the private sector doesn't mean that parental rights are being respected. Parents can actually face a diminution of their rights when the private sector gets involved, that makes them even more remote than when the federal government is on the scene. So, I think the analysis has to start with, on any issue or any group, the analysis has to start with, well, is this taking power and authority away from parents and the people? And that's the first question.
I have a quick question. Is the Heritage Foundation involved in this?
Yeah, Lindsay Burke at Heritage has written some excellent pieces on this. Yeah, Heritage has, yeah, and Cato Institute has. Heritage good, Cato good, AEI bad.
Yeah. Voting machine. The last hurdle down the road from all that's being proposed here for everybody to be aware of is that there will be a lot of people who should have voted no on this measure that did not fall in line, and so there's going to be a lot of replacements needed, and there's about 350 here in this room to be ideal candidates. And I hope you remember, don't get lost when we're looking for candidates some years down the road.
So I'll tell you what, we've had in this movement, we've had a couple of milestones that have really interjected a heightened energy and awareness into the movement. One was the fight at ALEC. One of them was in Indiana. One was last year at the Utah convention when our side printed a flyer, an anti-Common Core flyer, and passed it out at a convention and embarrassed the governor for his support of the Common Core. And another one was a rally in the Indiana Capitol, which seemed phenomenal, in mid-January of this year. This is before Malkin and Glenn Beck came onto the scene. But that rally, you know, no help from the press in advertising it. It was just the moms and the groups. They turned out on a Tuesday afternoon, school day, over 500 people. And notice of that and pictures of that rally went to the activists around the country and really interjected a lot of energy in it. I say that because there's like 200 people in this room. So you all can accomplish a lot. I dare say if you were all, this number of people were down at the State House to ask the governor, well, what are you going to do? Or just, you know, not what are you going to do, why don't you just tell us, you know, you like the Common Core and tell us why. I mean, just, you know, put it on the record.
Thank you for coming and speaking tonight. I have a basic question about, like, the new math. like, it's so much different from what I learned. And I know math is, like, the fundamental of problem solving. Doesn't this, the new math and these Common Core, isn't that going to fundamentally change the way our children think? Aren't they going to think different than, say, their parents on a different, in a different way?
Yeah, I think that's a profound statement and question. I mean, Sandra Stotsky says the ELA standards are going to do that by taking out the diminishing the study of classic literature. You know, I mean, we've had 40 years. We've been saying let's instill in children the love of learning. You're not going to instill the love of reading. You're not going to do that by having them read computer manuals. And the same thing with the math. I think it helps children, young children. You know, you learn the standard algorithm and you study the standard algorithm, and through that repetition, that's where you learn and appreciate the concepts. And that's also where you keep from getting frustrated about math. So the Common Core, the people who are teaching this, the two moms in Indiana got involved in it because their children were coming home with this Common Core stuff that was, you know, with all this fuzzy math. And, you know, you had to, when one example Heather Crossan gives was, you know, her daughter came home, second grade daughter came home with a problem that said, you know, one bridge is 400 feet long and one bridge is, next bridge B is 411 feet long. Which one is longer and why? And she answered it, well, bridge B is longer because 411 feet is more than 400 feet. And she got 1 out of 4 points for that problem because the right answer was, well, I looked at 400 and then I divided it up, you know, you go left to right I divided it out and I saw that there's 4 groups in the 100s column and no groups in the 10s column and none in the, and then on the 411, you know, you break it out left to right and then you go and explain it. That's one of the simpler Common Core problems.
We're going to take 4 more questions, and then I don't know if you're going to hang out
afterwards.
I'll
be here, yeah.
And then we're going to wrap it up because we're about 9:15. This will take us to close to 9, so I'll get you back there. All right.
In one of Michelle Malcolm's blogs, I think it was the first one I saw, there was an opt-out form. Mm. And I'm just wondering if that's just for show or does that have any power behind it? Number two, here's a ballpoint pen right there. Don't step on it.
Okay. yeah, that opt-out is successful. We don't know. The opt-out was done by a couple of activists, and basically it's a petition to the state to that saying you as a parent don't want your children engaged in this testing and stuff. So a couple parents we know of have submitted it, and the school system has responded and say no, you don't have the power to opt your children out. So I guess it's a case by case basis, but it's putting the issue on the table, I think.
We actually did it. We belong to the West Shore School District. And I quote, therefore, your request to opt out of instruction or assessment of the Common Core standards cannot be honored. Blah, blah, blah. Look at the white paper. We're not a curriculum. So you just, same thing from our legislature, the superintendent, the principal, they all had the same answer. So you can try, but at least they know we're awake and hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. So I'm telling you what.
From what I understand and the research that I've done on Common Core, we're saying that there's no curriculum involved, but Pearson is providing the e-books for Common Core, and Microsoft, the Gates Foundation, is providing the computers. Is that correct?
Yes.
And the teachers will eventually just become facilitators in the classroom rather than educators in the classroom. So
right.
If the children... And maybe what they're not supposed to think. As a teacher, I am an educator, and as a teacher, one of my principals' jobs is to teach children to think, to process, to analyze, to deduct information and, you know, deductive, inductive reasoning and all that sort of thing. How do we incorporate that into our children if those things are not, if they're just looking at a computer screen and they're not interacting with their teacher all day long?
Yeah, it's going to be a tremendous loss to the upbringing of formation of children. Teachers are going to be much more like administrators. And I think, you know, teaching is an art. It's a profession. It's a care of the person. And I don't think in any other profession that's a care of the person would you go for such a one-size, one-approach effort. You know, when you think of great teachers, you think of people that are passionate about their craft, and that passion, they express that passion through their personalities and connect to their students and inspire their students. And we're gonna lose that with the Common Core in the devaluing of the art of teaching. We wouldn't put up with this in any other profession, be it like the care of the person. Like, we wouldn't do it with the ministry. We wouldn't do it with law. People would be up in arms if we tried this approach with coaching. You know, we wouldn't do that with medicine. Well, maybe we would. Yes.
Yes, I think there's enough people in here of my age that can remember Nikita Khrushchev saying, "Give me one generation of your children, I'll give you a communist America." Right. How many have they got? Two, three, four generations now? It's well planted. Emmett, thanks for coming. Sure appreciate it.
No, thank you. Yeah. It's an honor.
A couple weeks ago, we had a similar meeting like this just down the road at Cross Keys Conference Center, and John Anthony spoke on Agenda 21, and he was emphatic. Time and time again, he said, don't take grants. And what you said was that Common Core was embedded in the stimulus package. And so we have the grant, and it's one grant after another grant after another grant, and the strings, they're pulling the strings right and left. Yeah.
And the grants stop, and then the commitments continue. The wreck is still there. I think there's something else that's going on, too. You know, when I was growing up, right, when a parent entered the schoolhouse, everyone knew a boss was in the building. And now, through this Common Core, not only are we diminishing the standing of teachers, we're diminishing the standing of the voter and of parents, and the taxpayer. Yeah, but what's going to happen though? I mean, that's children are. This leads, I think, to the disaffection of children. I mean, you grow up wanting to hold your teachers up high and think, you know, hold them up, and the same thing with parents, but the government's pushing them down. I think it's a sad state for the upbringing of children.
Well, thank you also for coming tonight. I cyber charter my son through Agora, which is the curriculum is K-12. I don't know if anybody's familiar with it. It used to be a fabulous curriculum. A year ahead compared to brick and mortar schools in the area. And what they just had a meeting on Common Core about 2 weeks ago. And it was really interesting because they said fundamentally nothing is going to change. They're going to just move a little bit of material forward a grade, backwards a grade. I said fundamentally that is a change. And then they came forward and said that they have been dumping Common Core material in their curriculum for a couple years now, which explains a lot because I know we have some other K-12 families that have noticed the curriculum's gotten a little funny in the last couple years. And they said, yeah, we're slipping it in. It's being dumped in there. So they're already putting it in and not telling us that that's what they're doing. They just now came clean with doing that. So if this, and K-12 is nationwide. They international. So this is a curriculum company that used to be very highly regarded, and now they're allowing this Common Core to drop their standards.
Yeah, this is this will be a fight, but I think though, you know, I get back to that. I think fundamentally we're an optimistic people, and fundamentally we know that we can change and we can take control of things. And I think that comes from our belief in our founding. And I think the legislators and your governor are going to be blindsided by what's going to hit them and how fast it's going to hit them. And they'll start whipping off the slogans, and people, you know, in the past, they've brushed away the voters, and the voters have gone away and come back with bigger numbers, angrier than before. And we should be angry about this, what's happened. This is our children. This is their liberty that's most at stake, and this is our Constitution.
Just have a comment here. We keep talking about the Board of Education, but according to state constitution here, the General Assembly shall provide, maintain, and support a thorough and efficient system of public education. So I called my state rep 4 weeks ago, knew nothing about it, would get back with me. 2 weeks later, I called again. Oh, he's checking into it. I'll get back with you again. So I invited him here tonight, and of course, he's not here. But just like they're giving up the state rights to the federal government or whoever, looks like they gave up to the Board of Education the responsibility of the General Assembly.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, in the states, the General Assembly has all the legislative power, and some of them, and I think this is at the urging of the progressives, in state after state, they like to say, oh, well, you know, that should really be decided by the State Board of Education. Well, the State Board of Education is supposed to manage the education system, but ultimately the legislature has overriding authority, and if the state board messes up, the legislators had better not abdicate. They had better fix it, and they're responsible at that point. So,
we know of a teacher who is attempting to bring the Japanese technique of teaching into the classroom here in the States. Do you know, is this related to the core?
I don't know. You know, the classic American style of teaching worked wonderfully, I believe. And over the years, we've had a gradual progressive creep, and you see this with literature, a gradual progressive creep, and it kind of works like the federal government works. So I say federal government's heavily involved, right? You know, there's a problem, there's a result that wasn't projected. People say, well, we should have had better results. And the progressives or the federal government never stop and say, well, maybe the problem was that initial tinkering we did. Their answer is always, well, the problem is we didn't tinker enough, so we need more money and more authority. But the classic American education, you know, I think it was went hand in hand with our founding, and it guarded it allowed people to fully exercise their liberties, and it stoked the imagination. I think I think we need to get back to that.
Emmett, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all.
I appreciate it. Emmett drove up here on his own dime, so I want to thank Emmett for coming. I do have a question. People were raiding your pile of DVDs over here, and they're all gone. Can we copy those DVDs?
Yeah. As I understand it, they... if they're copied, you lose quality. They're downloadable in four parts on, I guess, Truth in American Education or Stop Common Core, the group in Georgia. I can send you all more. You can order them through Concerned Women for America, I think the Georgia group. They'll do them for one or two. We're just giving ours away for free. So.
Okay. Well, that's fine. I mean, it is on the net. I've seen it on the net. There's a couple more things. Don't leave yet. There's a couple more things. The website that Leanne mentioned earlier, knowpacommoncore.com, has a petition on there. Please go on there and sign it. The other thing is that Leanne heads up the education committee, and what their main goal is to fight this Common Core. And this is exactly what Emmett's talking about, and it's getting housewives and mothers to work on this. And we have enough people here. I'm telling you, we can make a difference. This is what we can make a difference on. If you felt lousy after the November election, you thought, well, what am I doing here, man? I'm just going to prepare my family. This is the issue that you can do something on. And I want you to go out and tomorrow contact your state legislators. If they don't know anything about this, inform them. And I want to mention Will Tallman. Will Tallman's here. Is he still here? Thank you, Will. Thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it.
I forgot. I should have mentioned, too, Commonwealth Education Organization of Pennsylvania has been, they're up out in the Pittsburgh area, but please look them up on the website. They've been on this fight from the get-go and have done just great work on it.
Leanne sent out invitations to all our state legislators throughout York County. Will is the only one that came to the meeting, and I really appreciate it. I do want to ask Will something. What's your feelings on Common Core, and will you introduce a bill in the state house to stop Common Core in the state?
That's exactly why I'm here, to get information to be able to write that bill.
And that's great. So.
And just to tell you something else about the State Board of Education, I've testified in front of it four times, and I've lost four times, so I'm not very good with batting average with the State Board of Education.
That's okay. Keep on trying. You got to try and try and try. Now, the other thing is, I want to mention, someone just gave me this, April 23rd at Harrisburg at the Capitol, there's a rally for a gun bill, a House Bill 357. I don't know a whole lot about it, but I imagine it's to stop this gun control frenzy. But it's at 10 a.m. on April 23rd up at the Capitol. Emmett's going to hang around. Please go on our website. We're going to continue to update the website on what needs to be done about this issue, Common Core. I think Emmett's a fountain of information on this, and I hope you all enjoyed it. So thank you very much. Have a safe drive home. We'll see you next month.